हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम डॉक्टर हरी मोहन फ्रॉम सेंटर फॉर मेडिकल बायोटेक्नोलॉजी, महर्षि दयानंद यूनिवर्सिटी रोहतक, हरियाणा। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट ए मॉड्यूल, जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग एंड एप्लीकेशंस अंडर पेपर एनिमल सेल बायोटेक्नोलॉजी। द मेन ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ दिस मॉड्यूल आर टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग, व्हाट आर टिपिकल स्टेप्स to be followed during this genetic engineering process, what are the applications of genetic engineering in the field of medicine, diagnostics and animal health care, and what are its future perspective and scenario. Genetic engineering is a word which has been derived from two words, that is genome and engineering. So in the layman language, we can say it is engineering of gene. More precisely, we can say genetic engineering is a process of modifying the level of expression of a protein in a unnatural host and making a clone of a specific gene segment in another species of bacteria or insect cells. This field of genetic engineering is very exciting and it seems to be very promising, but it all started with the discovery of restriction enzymes, with the discovery of ligases and the concept that we can put a foreign gene in a plasmid. So this concept that we can combine two type of DNA and can make a hybrid DNA gave rise to the concept of genetic engineering. But today, with the data of complete human genome sequence in our hand, we can think anything. Earlier, the non-coding DNA was known as junk DNA. But today, people are trying to express genes from junk DNA, and they found that, yes, this junk DNA contains useful information. People are coming up with the idea that this junk DNA may be expressed in the expression vectors, and these proteins may serve as antibiotic or antimicrobial use, or some of the proteins can have anti-insect, or more specifically they can be used as insecticide or pesticides. So this seems to be very interesting, that earlier what we think that is a junk is a useful thing, and it all happened only due to genetic engineering techniques. The word genetic engineering has been derived from genome and engineering. So what is genome? Genome is complete set of genes of an organism. Genome encodes all the information of an organism. For example, human have 23 pair of chromosomes, which makes a complete genome of human. Each chromosome is made up of DNA, and a segment of chromosome which encode a particular protein or RNA is a gene. So we are considered about gene, how to change a gene which is occurring naturally there. If we want to change a segment of gene or complete gene, it will result into change in the product of that gene, that is protein, and that will result in change in the phenotype or change in the genotype of the organism. Using this characteristic of DNA, we can change the four-letter language in which all the information is stored in DNA for interest of human being. Expression vessels, it means the organism in which we can express protein of our interest. For example, E. coli is very commonly used for expressing human proteins. Human insulin was first expressed in E. coli. So it is like a vessel which is used for expression. For the expression of any other desired gene into the expression vessel, it requires promoter, it requires operator, proper reading frame, and a terminator sequence. Also, if we are using prokaryotic organism for expression, and the gene is from eukaryotic origin, so the introns need to be removed from exons so that only coding region is present, because in prokaryotes the splicing don't occur. So if we are expressing a human gene in E. coli, we need to give the cDNA of particular gene only. It must not contain introns, otherwise functional protein will not be formed. So these events have made an impact in the history of genetic engineering. We can say genetic engineering started with the DNA cloning technique developed by Bayer, Cohen and Berg in 1972-73. But before that, it was Mazur in 1869 who isolated DNA from white blood cells. Every provide the evidence that yes, it is DNA which is genetic material, not the proteins. Watson and Crick proposed double helix model on the work done by Franklin and Wilkins in 1953. And in 1955, Kornberg discovered DNA polymerase. 61, it was Marmer and Doty who discovered DNA renaturation. So all these discoveries helped Bayer, Cohen and Berg to perform the famous DNA cloning experiment. It was in 1975, Southern discovered the blotting technique for detection of DNA sequence. In 1975-77, Sanger proposed DNA dideoxy chain termination method and Maxim and Gilbert proposed chemical degradation method of DNA sequencing. In 1981-82, Palmter and Brinster produced transgenic mice and Sparling and Rubin produced transgenic fruit fly. In 1982, Gene Bank NIH public genetic database was established at NIH. It was in 1985 when the Kerry Mullis performed the very famous experiment of polymerase chain reaction. So Mullis is credited with the discovery of polymerase chain reaction, and it was in 1989 Field and Song developed the yeast-2 hybrid system. So these important discoveries, they paved the way of genetic engineering and paved the way how we can produce recombinant protein very easily. It was in 1995, Venter and colleague sequenced the first complete genome, and that was of bacterium Haemophilus influenzae. Till date, we have facility of sequencing complete human genome at a cheaper price. Earlier, it was in millions of dollars, but today, the complete human genome can be sequenced in $1,000. So this Human Genome Project has opened up the era of information. We have every kind of information about human genome, and that can be used in a positive way by means of genetic engineering tools. So exactly what we do in genetic engineering. The DNA from the target organism is isolated. For example, in case of plant or bacteria, C-type method can be used for DNA extraction. For animal, phenol chloroform method can be used for DNA extraction. After that, a target sequence or a part of gene or complete gene is targeted by PCR amplification and a segment is amplified. Then using different restriction enzymes, it is cut at a particular site. So both vector as well as target gene must be cut by the same enzyme so that they can combine with the sticky ends or blunt ends. So cutting of DNA like a scissor gave the idea of restriction enzyme. Basically, we can say there are three types of restriction enzyme, or more specifically restriction endonucleases, that is type 1, type 2 and type 3. The type 1 and type 3, they cut far from the site of recognition, but the type 2 restriction endonucleases cut at the same site where they recognize. That's why it is type 2 restriction enzyme which is used in genetic engineering. The enzyme can cut and can form a 5' overhang or 3' overhang, means sticky ends. Or it is possible that the enzymes may cut and form a blunt end. So depending on the end produced, the ligation can be done with the help of T4 DNA ligase. Blunt-to-blunt ligation or sticky-to-sticky ligation can be done during this genetic engineering experiments. this PCR product during this normal PCR by tech DNA polymerase, it produces a 3' A. So when the cloning vector with a T is used, it will produce TA type of cloning. So that is also an interesting way of cloning, how we can clone directly the PCR product by means of TA cloning vector. But ligation with a highly efficient ligases such as T4 DNA ligase is very important to make the hybrid DNA stable so that it can be transformed into the suitable host. So there are different steps in a typical genetic engineering experiment, and these steps are isolation of DNA and plasmid, second, cutting of DNA and plasmid, third, ligation and insertion, fourth, transformation in a suitable host, and fifth, expression of recombinant protein. So first step, that is isolation. Isolation of specific gene or target gene from donor involves extraction of total DNA. It can be human DNA, it can be animal DNA or plant DNA. So the total DNA is used for setting up PCR reaction, and a targeted gene is amplified. So that amplification of gene results in millions of copies of that particular segment, and that is then subjected to restriction enzyme digestion. From the bacteria also, the plasmid in which cloning is to be done, the plasmid is extracted by various methods, and the plasmid is purified and quantified. The DNA as well as vector which have been extracted is subjected to digestion with the restriction enzymes. These restriction enzymes act as molecular scissor, so they cut DNA at specific sites and they produce restriction sites. So these restriction sites can be sticky type or blunt type. In sticky also, it can be 5' overhang or 3' overhang. So when the DNA is subjected to cutting, the restriction enzyme will recognize a specific sequence also known as palindromic sequence and will cut in a particular fashion. Either it will produce 3' overhang, either it will produce 5' overhang, or produce a blunt-ended DNA, and that serves the purpose. If it is 5' overhang, so both 5' overhang can have complementary binding. So after cutting these sticky ends of vector and sticky end of target gene, they will make complementary binding by means of AT and GC pairing. So this AT and GC pairing support the complementary binding of target gene with the target vector. So after complementary binding, it is necessary that their end should be ligated, and this process of ligation is completed with the help of DNA ligase. DNA ligase is an enzyme which anneal the cut end of DNA. But here in the genetic engineering experiment, specifically highly efficient DNA ligase are used. So mostly it is T4 DNA ligase which is extracted from T4 bacteriophage, and it have high activity and result in rapid ligation of the DNA ends. So this DNA ligase resulted in joining of the digested DNA ends, and it form a complete DNA molecule which contains vector DNA and the target gene. So after the DNA ligated the vector DNA with the target DNA, it is ready to be inserted in the host. So this hybrid plasmid which contains gene of interest can be inserted either in bacteria or in yeast or in insect cells or mammalian cell lines, depending on the requirement. What is the requirement for protein expression and what kind of promoter, operator and terminator site the plasmid have. Transformation can be defined as a process of uptake of DNA from the environment. So when a bacterial cell uptake DNA from the environment and integrate that DNA in its own genome. So that process is known as transformation. But in case of genetic engineering, transformation is done by making pores in the cell wall of bacteria. So the pores can be made by various methods. Making pore can be also called as making the cells competent. So the cells, the bacterial cells, can be made competent by calcium chloride method or calcium chloride, rubidium chloride method, or by using some other commercial kits. These bacterial cells can be made competent, means their pore size increases, and through these pores, the recombinant DNA which contains gene of insert can be inserted into the host. So it is also possible that if the efficiency is less, we can give heat soak. When we give the heat soak at 42 degrees Celsius, the size of pore of this competent cell will increase, and with the increase in size of pores, the recombinant DNA can enter inside the host cell easily. So this process of transformation impart unique property to the bacterial cell. So the bacteria which will receive the recombinant DNA will get some additional properties like antibiotic resistance. So it will get a marker. So that bacteria will be resistant to specific antibiotic for which there is a gene is there. For example, ampicillin resistance or kanamycin resistance will be there. By this marker, we can differentiate the transformed cells from non-transformed cells. So that is very important, because if we cannot separate transformed cells from non-transformed cells, it will be very difficult for the scientists to screen all the cells. So by just selecting the transformed cell, it is quite easy to search for the protein of interest, to search for the gene of interest in the transformed clone. So when we are looking for expression, many things need to be taken in consideration. What is the size of target protein? What is the nature of target protein? Whether the target protein is modified or not? So all things need to be taken in consideration. What is the stability of the target recombinant protein? Whether the target recombinant protein form inclusion bodies inside the cell? So whether the target protein is secretory in nature or it will be stored as inclusion body inside the bacterial cell? So all these factors will determine what kind of expression vector we will take and what kind of host we will select for expression. So by taking care all these factors, a suitable expression vector and suitable host is taken. In case where we want to first clone in prokaryote and then express in eukaryote, we can use subtle vector that can have two kind of promoters, or that can multiply in prokaryote as well as eukaryote, or that can have two kind of oocytes so that it can multiply in different type of species. So subtle vector is also an important vector when we talk about expression. The expression level can be judged by Western blotting. We can see whether the target protein, whether the target recombinant protein is there in the sample or not by just doing Western blotting using the specific antibodies to that recombinant protein. So all these steps can be summarized in this figure as DNA and plasmid is extracted from their respective source, and then they are subjected to digestion with the same restriction enzyme. So digestion with same restriction enzyme will produce sticky ends, and these sticky ends are complementary. They will make complementary base pairing with the help of DNA ligase. They can be ligated and then they can be transformed into the required host. Most commonly it is E. coli, because E. coli is very easy to handle and it's very easy to insert the recombinant plasmid in the E. coli. After the recombinant plasmid is inside the host and it have all the elements required for expression of any protein, means operator, promoter and termination site, the expression will start. The gene will be transcribed and later on translated. It is also important to note here that if the gene is of eukaryotic origin and it is to be expressed in prokaryotes, it must not be post-translated modified, because prokaryotes lack most of the post-translational modification. For example, the protein must not be glycosylated because there is no post-translation glycosylation process in prokaryotes. Although nowadays we have strains of E. coli which can specifically produce glycosylation or any other post-translational modification. So we have specialized strain of E. coli for this purpose. So DNA fragments of different size can be cloned in the same vector, and after transformation, they will form different colonies. So these different colonies can be picked and can be processed accordingly. So we can clone DNA fragment of any size, and for every size we require specific vector. With the increasing size of DNA fragment, we require vectors which can accommodate larger segments such as BAC vector, YAC vector, etc. So why there is need of genetic engineering? Genetic engineering have many applications. It have n number of applications in medical field, in plant field, and in microbial biotechnology. So in medical field, the most important is therapeutic use, that is also known as gene therapy. So to insert the defective gene and replace the gene which is causing disease is the target of gene therapy. Second is to produce genetically modified organism to cure genetic disease by replacing the defective genes, to produce essential protein in different organism, to produce combinations of gene from different organism that are impossible to occur naturally, and vaccine production and diagnostics production are also main objectives or main applications of genetic engineering in medical field. So today we will discuss these applications in detail. The recombinant protein can be used for therapeutic purpose. So therapeutic cloning also serves as an important arm of genetic engineering to produce biopharmaceuticals which can be used for treating various diseases, and to produce or to change the defective gene inside the body. So this therapeutic use of recombinant proteins are immense. Almost all clotting factors have been expressed in the form of recombinant proteins, and many other hormones and enzymes have been expressed, and these recombinant proteins have the same efficiency as that of natural proteins. The defective gene in the patient can be replaced with the normal gene. The first successful treatment was done in a Sri Lankan female, that was Asanthi De Silva, for the disease SCID. So the defective gene was replaced in the leukocytes, and these leukocytes were placed back in the body and they were functioning normally. So this was the first successful case of gene therapy, and from this case it all started a cascade that how we can treat different genetic abnormalities. This slide shows a list of proteins, more specifically recombinant proteins. So these recombinant protein, they are used in specific disease conditions. For example, lapirudine is an anticoagulant, and that is used for treatment of disseminated intravascular coagulopathy associated with heparin. Sarcoplase is a thrombolytic drug which is used for acute myocardial infarction. Datiplase is also thrombolytic, that is used for acute myocardial infection. Interleukin 2 is used for treatment of renal carcinoma. Interleukin 11 for treatment of thrombocytopenia, interferon beta 1b is used for therapeutics of multiple sclerosis, interferon gamma for treatment of chronic granulomatous disease. This blood clotting factor, factor 8, is used for treatment of hemophilia A, factor 9 for hemophilia B. So you can see how easy it has become to obtain this factor. Earlier, these factors were extracted from killing the animals and they were very expensive. With the help of genetic engineering, these recombinant proteins, they are getting cheaper and they are available for normal human being also. Factor 7 is used for treatment of both hemophilia A and B. Dorsal alpha is used for treatment of cystic fibrosis. These proteins are also recombinant in nature and they are used depending on the purpose. For example, erythropoietin alpha is a hematopoietic factor and used for anemia associated with renal failure and HIV infection. Erythropoietin beta is also used for anemia associated with renal failure. Insulin lispro, that is also a recombinant protein and very commonly used, is used for treatment of diabetes. HCG, that is human chorionic gonadotropin, is used for super ovulation in case of assisted reproductive techniques. FSH is used for treatment of infertility and recombinant LH is used for induction of ovulation. Here we can say that these recombinant protein, they are handy and they are getting cheaper and they are easily available. We don't need to sacrifice animals for extracting these proteins. So we can say genetic engineering have changed the way how we use to treat disease conditions. As we know that there are many inherited or chromosomal abbreviated diseases which have no cure. But with the advent of genetic engineering, there is a hope that the defective gene or the defective chromosome can be repaired. So there are chances that with the help of gene therapy, the defective gene can be replaced by normal gene through homologous recombination. But that is also a thing of future, because till date, very few successful cases of gene therapy have been observed. So there is debate whether gene therapy is a success or it's a failure. In cases of restenosis, that is reblockage of coronary artery after they have been opened by bypass surgery or angioplasty, there is again and again blockage occur. So these blockages occur due to deficiency of vascular endothelial growth factor. So what was done? 13 patients were injected in heart with a DNA encoding for this factor, vascular endothelial growth factor. And this factor promoted angiogenesis. All the 13 patients had improved heart function. So we can say in this case, gene therapy was a success. But on the other hand, inability to produce ornithine transcarbamylase caused a disease, and efforts were done to replace this defective gene with a normal gene. So Jesse Gelsinger was a young volunteer in the gene therapy trial who had a moderate OTC deficiency. But the volunteer died on 17 September 1999. The probable reason of death may be high concentration of adenovirus that expressed OTC. It may be possible that the massive immune response against the virus might have killed the volunteer. So in this case, gene therapy appears a failure. But by single example, we cannot say it's a success or it's a failure. It need to be standardized further. It need to be refined. And then only we can say whether it is useful or not. Genetic engineering is also used for producing genetically modified organisms, popularly known as GMOs. GMOs are the recombinant protein expressing bacteria, Most commonly, it is E. coli which produce a number of biopharmaceuticals. Although other microbes can also be used for inserting certain gene of interest. GMO can be used very successfully for bioremediation. Recently, China has used these GMOs for cleaning of oil spills in the sea, and it was a successful operation. So every country is making guidelines, policies for regulations regarding GMO, but our country is still awaiting for strict regulations regarding GMOs. Another advantage of genetic engineering is to produce essential protein in different organisms. So these proteins, which are required for different functions, they can be expressed in the suitable host, for example, human insulin, coagulation factors, hormones, etc. They can be expressed in suitable hosts, either E. coli, yeast, insect cells, or mammalian cells, depending on the requirement and amount of recombinant protein required for the test. So in medical sciences, recombinant protein can be used for developing diagnostic kits. So antigenic and highly immunogenic protein of virus or bacteria or protozoa or fungus can be selected, and it can be expressed in E. coli or yeast. So that high amount of antigenic protein can be used for raising specific antibodies in rabbits, or it can be used directly as antigen for standardizing ELISA or radioimmunoassay or any other immunoassay such as Western blotting. So this recombinant DNA technology has opened up novel ways for standardizing diagnostic kits, for developing diagnostic kits, and it had made the field of diagnosis easy. Recombinant protein can be used for vaccine production. If we can identify a specific epitope which is highly immunogenic, that can be expressed in higher amount. And the very successful example of recombinant vaccine is hepatitis B vaccine, where the hepatitis surface antigen has been expressed in yeast and it is used as a vaccine. So for other pathogens also, the epitope which is highly immunogenic can be identified, and that can be used as a vaccine. To conclude or to summarize the module, we can say the most important application of genetic engineering will be deciphering the location, function, and interaction of genes present in wide variety of living organism. Elucidation of the function of junk DNA. Earlier, junk DNA was considered to be useless, but nowadays it has been proposed that this junk DNA also have important function. To elucidate what is its function and how it can be used will pave way for treatment of many genetic diseases, and it will answer many questions which were earlier unanswerable. Now, human being is close to making artificial genome and artificial cell. So once artificial genome and artificial cell is formed, human being will be able to form artificial life. So genetic engineering is getting more and more important as we are moving in the direction of artificial life. So potential of commercialization of recombinant proteins have converted biotechnology industry into a more than $45 billion venture, and the amount is increasing day by day when the newer and newer recombinant proteins are coming in the market. So we can say genetic engineering has changed the way how disease was treated. The recombinant proteins have changed the way how vaccines were formed, how diagnostics were developed, and it have changed totally the way of medicine. It may be possible that after 10 years or 20 years, we may forget antibiotic and we may start using something else for treating infectious as well as lifestyle disease. So this will be the impact of genetic engineering. Thank you very much.